be banned away from Lulex, though, first up? The answer is Gangplank, surprisingly enough.
Yeah, Freak touched about it earlier in the last champ, so like these high percentage bans will generally come out on the red side, so you can think Gangplank can get banned here, maybe Kalista, if you're really afraid of her, will still be banned on the red side, because those are champion picks with too much influence if they get to the first pick on blue side. Lulu is one of those other champions right here, so that's some of the bans that we could expect out of H2K.
Yeah, Mordekaiser, Zedarius, some other options there as well for Bangkok Titans. They're going to ban away the Thresh, so not wanting to let that go to round two, looking to try and get a different priority pick. Mordekaiser, no surprises there on that ban. Trying to keep it even, you know, ban percentages.
Well, Tabe said get rid of Lulu so that G4 has an easier time assassinating people. Of course, Ryu would be just fine on a Lulu, actually. Odwamna has actually been the big carry right now. He's actually number two of all top laners of this tournament in terms of damage share. So setting up Odwamna actually has been reasonably good for H2K, to be honest.
Yeah, and speaking about Lulu as well, I mean, it is actually a first pick that the Bangkok Titans can go for. They are going to ban away
the bench
Tom
Kench. Bench.
They are definitely bottling the axolotl here. This is Warlock. Not going to be able to do that. But last ban for H2K. We'll see what they do decide to take away from the Rift. And the Lulu is an option because Warlock, he plays that in the top lane. It's a safe top lane pick as well. And Warlock hasn't necessarily been the strong player on the Bangkok Titans despite being their shot caller. You may as well put him on something that can sit back and just control the lane.
Yeah, well, the last game was very close. It did evolve from the way HK drafted a composition. You can see in the bottom of your screen last time, they played full-on assassin pick composition. But they ended up grouping for a lot of fights with it because they had Mordekaiser, so it's
right.
Quite weird right here. Let's see if HK get more of a traditional team composition right here, so because they still have a shot, you know, if they win this match right now and they beat EDG later on, they still have a shot of tying EDG, I believe, so that's definitely what they're playing for, so you may see a slightly more conventional by the numbers H2K coming out of here.
And that's the thing, when we saw just yesterday, the wildcard team basically tying for third place with Counter Logic Gaming, so the Bangkok Titans can live up to that and tie H2K with one win apiece if all goes according to BKT here. H2K definitely, as you were saying, very happy that Edward Gaming had lost the game just to go, because we might see in game five of the day that battle for second place between these two teams. Right now, taking their time with their first round picks on the red side.
I mean, coming into the tournament, you would expect here just a generic jungle pick and a Braum support pick for Kasing. This was more in the 5.14 era, so obviously a lot of things have changed. HK looked like they still value Darius here, and Kalista obviously was never picked on red side in 5.14 because she was never open and available on red side, so she's open like that. I like to see Kasing play with Kalista usually because he can play even more aggressive, and Hyaren and Kasing have good synergy when it comes to using Fate's Call, both defensively and aggressively.
What's interesting to me, though, is the fact that Gragas didn't get picked up their first round for H2K because of the jungle bans, the Rek'Sai, and the Elise both being gone. Gragas is basically next on the list for both these junglers here. I'm not surprised. It obviously go to BKT, but the fact that H2K cared more about the Darius than the Gragas is interesting to me.
We have seen Lulex has played some Lee Sin so far, especially against teams that you rate personally weaker, where you think you can find more openings for aggressive ganks and just dash back. He could end up picking up that that Lee Sin and have that as an option for more aggression in the early game, more snowballing, get the Darius ahead, get the Kalista ahead, and that could be the approach. Obviously, I think if HTK could, they would have picked all three champions at once, but obviously, only two at a time.
And instead, they're just picking multiple knockups here, of course, with G4 being able to play potentially that Yasuo. That is so many opportunities to get that last breath off, but HTK now to answer. And also, you know, just strong picks in themselves.
I mean, I think Ryu can blind pick his mid laner expecting a Yasuo matchup.
Yeah,
now,
almost.
Realistically, I think that's very, very likely here for him. Crap, but you talk about Lee Sin, you're right about this one. It's already had two Lee Sin bans against him in three games so far. This, of course, being the fourth here for Lulex. So if we go by popularity, that's probably next up for him.
It's pretty hard to draft here for H2K because Bangkok Titans, they've picked three champions, but they're so generic that they can go into pretty much any direction with it. They fill many different roles. They don't have any weaknesses. We see the expected Lee Sin come out here, and we have the Kalista Annie lane that is incredibly potent with trading and just blowing people up. We could see a TF come out here, but Ryu just wants to wait because he doesn't really want to play that matchup TF into Yasuo.
So this is probably a little bit far-reaching, but back when Prolly was a mid laner over North America, Annie was his Yasuo counterpick, actually, because so many of her spells go through the wind wall, targeted stuns useful. This seems very unlikely,
Where did it get him, though?
It got him to Worlds as a coach. His mind for the game, much better than his mechanics.
That's true. And I mean, that's what we're talking about here, so that certainly works out. But Bangkok Titans now with 20 seconds to go. They have to round out this comp. We'll see whether it is going to be the Yasuo, of course, with Lulu heading towards the top lane. It means they can balance out that magic damage and physical damage. So it is an option here.
I mean, Yasuo Tristana is something we could see here because it provides another knock
up. That's another
generally when, or knock back. Generally, when you see Kalista, Tristana is the answer because that matchup tilts 1v1 trading. It, almost on every auto attack, up to 6 or 7, Tristana wins, and after 7 auto attacks, you're actually dead anyways as Kalista, so that's why you want to do that. The matchup against the range support makes it tough, though. Alistar can't really punish Kalista Annie, so we may still see a lane swap necessary to get through the early stages of the game here.
All right, well, Ryu to play his fourth mid laner in 4 games, we expect. Already played LeBlanc, already played Lulu, already played Echo. And maybe he goes back to LeBlanc, actually, for the matchup itself.
It's low on Wakeflare, then. Snowball again, but again, last time when H2K faced off against Bangkok Titans, they went full-on Assassin. Their Wakeflare mid was Echo, I believe, so not all too worried about that, it seems. They just want to blow people up with this composition.
No, Lissandra comes through, so a different point-and-click stun for this champion. Still can lock up the Yasuo, and in fact, his dash, that E, does get interrupted by Ruth, so Lissandra can easily create distance by W-ing while he's mid-dash and getting away.
Yeah, and what I really love is the massive pick potential here as well. You Glacial Path in, you get that Frozen Tomb down, and it can mean that Oduwane can get to that point of being massive with the Noxian Might. He can start beating the heck out of people after that initial pick, with the help of Tibbers there as well from Kasim.
Yeah, I agree. H2K's composition definitely very good at setting up for this Darius. A lot of ways to go in. You expect Righteous Glory or Talisman of Ascension to come out from Kasing in the support role. So setting up for a big Darius carry, and Oduwane has been the carry for this team this tournament. See if that works out for him.
Incredibly well-rounded composition for BKT though. If they get through the early game and they don't get smashed by a couple of aggressive ganks and they can avoid these, you know, roams from Kasing where he lands the Flash Tibbers, their teamfight composition later on in the game is actually incredibly strong. They have double tank for Peel, they have a wind wall to cut off one of the entrance points to the fight. They have a holistic counter to Juggernauts and just pick composition with the Lu who can just kite them for days. And then generally they have one hyper carry in the back, Tristana, who can actually get a Zeke from the Alistar. So there is a certain, there's a really good win condition here for BKT if they can play to their strengths, which is something we haven't really seen from the weaker teams in this tournament overall.
We'll see if BKT can do that. I think this is one of the best comps we've seen from them all tournament long. So if you guys think they can do it, then tweet your predictions into @LaLeeSports on Twitter. Tweet the hashtag BKTWin or the hashtag H2KWin. We'll see who comes out on top from the fan vote. Of course, in about 35 minutes, we'll see who comes out from the game itself. But we are here, Bangkok Titans, with a chance to look at a tie for third place in the group. H2K basically need this win if they want a chance of making quarterfinals because they can face Edward Gaming at a possible tiebreaker a bit later on in the day. Guys, let us know how it's going to go because our game is getting started in just a minute.
Yeah, just a minute. And of course, G4 on his Yasuo as well. Incredibly excited to see this. I mean, we saw it all through the IWCQ when they qualified here. We saw it before at IWCI as well. This guy loves his assassins and really wants to be able to set this one up. But I like the fact that they've also included a whole lot of skirmishing and team fighting prowess here because this is a team that doesn't necessarily focus on, you know, the macro play moving around the map. They just want to fight you at any possible time ever, and they just don't think about it. So, I mean, giving them a lot of tools to do this as well.
Yeah, we do have a bit of a short pause. That's why I was already getting caster position close to the screen. It's like, oh, coming back to us. But yeah, what BKT have to be incredibly careful of is this wealth of AoE crowd control, whether it's a Fate Call, knock up on multiple people followed by a Tibbers, or Lissandra just diving to your backline and pressing R on herself. If they can survive that initial wave of damage, H2K, they kind of drop off the grid when it comes to damage, unless Darius gets that reset. You know, that is what they're looking for. One kill and all hell breaks loose, because if Darius doesn't die 5 seconds later, you touch on it, you know, the 5 stacks coming out, then things do get rough.
Yeah, but what they do have is a lot of ability to get that first kill. That's sort of the whole point. They sort of looked at Lissandra and went, okay, well, at least we can now just completely pick someone off and get this fight going in their favor. Plus Rend as well, fantastic kill securing ability to try and get this Darius going.
Yeah, the initial way to start a fight, definitely going to be a struggle for H2K. Just to keep you guys at home updated, Moss didn't connect to the game. We have the game paused to see what's going on. So as we figure out what the connection issue is, if it's his computer, we'll get that sorted in a second.
Doesn't want to play that matchup. Playing Alistar is an incredibly, I guess, it's a bit of a boring matchup into double range because you have to spec into heal early. So you basically become a heal bot and then you rely on Lloyd.
You stomp around yelling a lot.
Yelling while you hope your AD carry avoids poor trades 2v1. And you just want to go even on CS up until the point where somebody overextends or you get a gank and then suddenly that combo becomes gold for engaging and then you can get the kill.
I want to ask you about a matchup actually here. talking about Annie, because I went and looked at picks and bans and the builds that players had. When Mako played Annie up against SKT last week, he actually maxed the Q, the single target damage, Disintegrate on Annie. Is that actually normal? I thought it was normally W for like more AoE burst.
I've always liked playing Annie with Q max, because I feel in an entire rotation, your Q will come up again and you can do a one extra damage spell. But overall, when you look at team fights, the second your W hits two people, and you want to go for multiple people tibbers, then W kind of trails ahead. I don't think the cooldown shifts on any of the abilities. I think Annie's Q and W are static, so it's only damage. But Q is half the cooldown of a W. So overall, you're more likely on single targets. Q max is better. If you're very confident in yourself and you think, well, I'm going to consistently land multiple man tibbers and Ws, then W max is the better approach. But for short lane trades, if they happen to go as far as 5 seconds, 6 seconds, getting the second Q with more damage in as they walk away could win you those trades. But we've seen this tournament so far, very, very few bot lane trading, because every time you step forward for a trade, well, you have two teleports behind you, and then you learn your lesson.
Yeah, I was actually going to mention the two teleports as well, because we were talking about Bangkok Titans, the fact that they don't necessarily move around the map quite as well, but now we've got H2K with the double teleport. The fact that now Bangkok Titans, they need to be very careful about where they're moving on the map so that they don't get caught out by what they used to get themselves here in the first place.
Yeah, well, it's going to be the thing to watch for. G4, not with the playmaking to get around the map. He's going to be all about the one-on-one, the exhaust in the mid lane. Double TP from H2K, going to be trying to make, again, those aggressive moves all around the map, trying to make things happen with all their engage tools.
Yeah, and Ryu is actually just an incredibly smart player when it comes to that. When H2K play triple carry comps into double carry comps, Ryu is actually very smart, and he likes to trade his life to just take out another carry. And if you do that equally, suddenly the game becomes two carries versus one, and it's incredibly hard to just win a fight on a single carry. As we saw one game in the European LCS, Ryu was playing Twisted Fate against SK Gaming, and he would continuously just dive in, take out one guy with him in his grave, drop dead, but that way the fight would propel forward in a manner that Hjarn could continuously clean up untouched in the back. We may see this exactly the same if Ryu plays that way on Lissandra.
But the game is unpaused, ladies and gentlemen. We're on to the Rift for the Bangkok Titans taking on H2K. Bangkok Titans looking for some revenge to try and get themselves a win on the board.
And meanwhile, H2K looking for their path into the quarterfinals. They win here and they beat Edward Gaming a couple games later. They have that ability to tie break if all else goes according to seeding.
Well, Moss and G4 now hanging out in the river. It's a pretty standard defensive start here. We've seen a lot of teams grouping up, trying to get that deep vision. But this time, everyone's just chilling out, observing the waters at the moment.
They're pretty waters.
Yeah, well.
Kind of nice waves going through.
Exactly. Beautiful. Slightly girls with bears on their back as well.
The scenic route of Summoner's Rifts. Slightly losing matchup in the bot lane, as we touched on earlier, for Lloyd and Moss, but it's manageable with heals. Whereas Darius kind of gets countered by Lu pretty hard in lane, gets kited, gets denied, range versus melee.
So does Gnar as well,
that is
apparently.
When you face Bengi, most things are losing matchup.
Bengi wins any matchup. So this is why actually Odawamne is opting into a double jungle to get past those rough early few levels. Also, Darius Lee Sin has a pretty decent double jungle overall. H2K initiating lane swap here. And they secure themselves two quadrants of the jungle, so no 3-buff shenanigans, anything. They may actually get more if they actually invade here on the enemy. We may see that from Kasing and Hjarn.
I think this is really smart, just in general as well, from H2K, because it was a weakness that was worked out by a lot of the other IWC teams when the Bangkok Titans were actually getting here, is we do have a little bit of an invade coming through. Warlock does manage to get away, but 007X taking a lot of damage.
Ooh,
they take
one of the blue pieces.
That's a big deal.
Now G4 winning in the first trade against Ryu, though, so advantages across the map, but I think it's definitely a better one for the HK duo lane to steal part of the blue buff away and really screw this duo jungle.
Yeah, you can't afford to start there with no wards defending the jungle entrance. You know, if you've played any scrims, you know that this is a viable strategy. If H2K opt to predict the lane swap or lane swap themselves, this is exactly what they're going to do almost every game. This isn't something new. BKT should have been ready for this.
Yeah, this is the weird thing. Like, from all my experience playing competitive games, things like this are very easy to practice against zero people. I even, like, had a team where we practiced lane swaps at a 5-0 just to get the repetitions down right. So that's honestly very surprising that BKT screwed this one up, but they're behind because of it.
Well, it's what Bangkok Titans couldn't do. They couldn't actually work out how to play against a lot of these lane swaps. It was considered their weakness, and then they used double teleport to try and make up for that issue, the fact that they just try and get themselves into a regular laning scenario. But happening this time. And Lulex is just going to come in and say thank you very much.
Yeah, Moss did the same thing Kasing did. He just did it later. He's like, oh, support's moving into the enemy jungle instead of sitting in lane. That's a great idea. I'm going to do that too. He's going to be moved in, but it's too late. They're behind on the tempo. Probably like stating it whenever you talk to him about lane swap. He says they're behind on the play. And HTK right now, they're ahead on the play because their tower is already melting. The wave will be bounced back for Oduwamne, and he will spiral ahead in what initially was a losing matchup.
This is really impressive as well by Hjarnan. He's actually saving auto attacks, making sure he's rending the last and everything, just optimizing the amount of damage he has to deal to the minion waves. They're setting up this turret, and looks like they're giving the gold to the AD carry. Mid lane matchup, still a close one. Exhaust used for not much.
You can cancel the Sandra's E if you knock her up roughly in the period where you predict her to use her E. So if that knockup came slightly later from G4, Ryu would not be able to proc the second part of his E and the relocate. That means Ryu would have likely had to flash. So that's a matter of milliseconds. Wait, that knockup just came slightly later. G4 could have actually forced the flash there in the mid lane. Maybe that's why he exhausted.
Well, Bangkok Titans are going to utilize the fact that Tristana pushes turrets extraordinarily quickly to lock down that turret despite being a little bit late to that party. And both mid laners did head back. Well, actually Ryu, he's made his way back towards the lane now.
And Oduwamne right now didn't preserve that perfect freeze because he knows he will be matched. When Darius bounces the wave towards himself, he wants to farm that for a while, but if somebody comes in and pushes him under the tower, the benefit of that freeze is actually turned around against you. So now you can see Oduwamne starting to push out in the top lane. Then he frees up as a resource as well, and H2K can move him around the map. They actually like diving bot lane with freeing up the resource that is Oduwamne. If not, they'll just swap the lanes around and keep him away from that Lulu, avoiding that poor matchup and propelling his farm. Look at it, 16-3. Yes, that can even out, but it'll take time for Warlock. In that time, Oduwamne is free to do whatever he wants on the map.
And we'll see where he goes. Track it for the next couple of minutes here. Right now, the bot lane matchup already looking good for H2K. You can see they're plus 10 minions right now, and you talk about double ranged versus a melee support, and you can see how far back Lloyd and Moss have to play. They don't have the tools to win this matchup.
Yeah, massive wave being pushed in the bottom too. So pressure everywhere except mid lane here for H2K. And they're using that to just get Lulex in a good position potentially to make some plays, find the enemy jungle later on.
Yeah, a lot of damage coming down there as well as Hjarnan gets a lot of spears into Lloyd. Moss hanging around. They do have G4 cheating towards the bottom side. Actually, there's going to be the pulverizers. Kasing, Boss used the flash to get back out. Exhaust down onto Hjarnan. As there's a flame blitz left and he misses it. The slow goes down and they're now focusing on this Kalista as Lloyd
still
two spears in him, but not enough. G4 even making his way into the party, but Oduwamne's here as well. Is Kasing going to fall down? The heal comes out. Nice flash after the E as G4 is going to have to back away. Headbutt to try and disengage as everyone's here for the bottom lane party.
What an amount of misplays right there. Beautiful opening from Moss. That Q flash into W was absolutely the correct play, especially if your jungler is coming around the corner. But then jump should be buffered so it procs on Annie or not use it all.
Yeah,
so you can still get her when she runs. Hjarnan was overextended trying to peel, but he didn't get punished. The fact that 007X misses a body slam flash is an incredibly large misplay.
He could have just gone for Hjarnan instead of trying to greed for Kasing. And if you hit Kasing, you kill him, and that's actually a good play, but to get nothing at all for a summoner spell, huge mistake.
Well, Lulex is actually, I believe, discovering 007X here, but doesn't look like 007X is going to be in too much trouble. G4 making his way around.
Sightstone already done for Lulex, actually. Rushed that item first. No longswords, no upgraded smite. So he gets to invade for free here, which he's got to feel good as a Lee Sin player.
And Lulex very often gets the criticism that he doesn't help his lanes. Well, I'm just going to ward for them. Let them help themselves.
Hey, it is helping.
I mean, he is playing Lee Sin. If he's just trying to play a farm game against Kraken, it's not a good way to play the matchup. So maybe we'll see more from him. But you can see the attempt at a trade right there. 3-4 hit Ren definitely does a lot of damage. And keep in mind, there's still a Vamp Scepter on Hjarnan here. So he's going to have an easy time taking trades like this.
The thing to be said for Lloyd is the fact that he's now caught back up in that farm. Only a couple behind.
Yeah.
A little bit more of a wave there for Hjarnan. G4 is still just clearing out this minion wave, and we'll see.
He's tied with Ryu.
Yeah, how this top lane, middle lane works.
But yeah, top lane minus 14. The ulti comes across from the Fog of War. G4 really wants this fight. Don't believe he blocked any of the spells with the wind wall, but
he was looking for the glacial path there with the wind wall to stop that one from coming out.
Yeah, you could even stop her Q if you time it literally perfectly from hitting you.
Instead, Ryu just walks away casually.
Lose half his health, but he's got some potions to stay back up with, so it shouldn't be too bad. Kasing just misses the stun there. Wanted to tag Lloyd. That would have been a really brutal trade there.
Yeah, the entire dynamic of this lane changes at level 6, because Anya can obviously play very aggressively with the threat of Tibbers and Fate's Call being defensively. But Moss can also start fights where he can actually wait for his AD carry to follow up a lot longer, because he will have the Alistar ultimate available to him to basically become unkillable, especially since Yharnam and Kasing, when they want to threaten a target, they need to use cooldowns. You will never use a cooldown on an ultimated Alistar, so he can actually just stand there and not take any damage at all for a very large amount of time.
Looks like a Blue Boss Steal is going to come through here for H2K as well. Seem to have that one's number. Ryu is going to lock that one down as well. G4 making his way towards mid lane. Of course, G4 doesn't mind about it too much. Probably one of the worst champions with the blue buff in the game.
Yeah, but the map is being divided. It looks even, you know. This team gets a blue buff, this team gets a blue buff. But at the same time, because the top side of the map is so heavily H2K favored, that means Oduamne is playing without any constrictions, and that's why he's trailing ahead in CS right now. Look at the numbers. 30 CS already ahead. And again, a losing early game matchup. H2K played around that beautifully. They were ahead of the play, and they got Oduamne ahead, and now he's reaping the benefits.
Yeah, think about it. We're equal in kills, we're equal in turrets, and yet H2K is up 900 gold as a team, and that's because of lane matchups. Their bot lane's pushed in and yet outfarming their top lane, just ahead by more than double in CS now. I mean, so many things going H2K's way, and the game just going slow like this is totally fine for these guys.
Yeah, and the fact that Warlock as well, he was just wandering around the river for the last, I believe, about 5 minutes, waiting for his wave to head back towards that inner turret because it was too dangerous for him to head out that far, especially against Oduamne.
Yeah, and especially against passive teams, or teams that are playing as passive as BKT, your teleport generally comes up every time a play is made. Usually, the way you punish teleports, well, you make a play, you take a loss, but then the next fight, they don't have teleport anymore, and you can maybe make a play in a favorable matchup somewhere else, but BKT is too afraid to do that, so every time right now they're going to make a move, H2K will be ready with double teleport, and then it just promotes such a passive game right now, which is in favor while H2K is still ramping up for that mid-game spike.
Of course, they've got three threats.
Yeah, looking to finish off the static shift now as he heads back to base, but Ryu making his way up, and it just feels like H2K are biding their time. It feels like they're just more than happy to get this one done.
So we can see what else H2K wants to do then. Of course, they're happy to wait around, but as the team that's supposed to be a bit better, we'll see what kinds of plays they can make for themselves as they hope to eke some kind of advantage. Dragon's up, bot lane's pushing, but Tristana just got to recall for BF Sword, so Yharnam's next choice should be to run away and go back to base. This trade should actually make that even more likely.
Yeah, Hippo Pulverize did land. There's the Ren, though, as the Tibbers comes down. Moss doesn't have level 6 yet. Ryu comes in. Nice exhaust, but it's not enough. Frozen Tomb on Deloitte, but now he's able to get the auto-attacks up, picks up the kill on Ryu, jumps forward, the flash is there, but that Fate's Call was so well timed. Kasing in there as well as W7X, so close to dead. Oduamne picks up Lloyd. Wild Growth comes in, but Warlock, oh my goodness, that shield was so good. G4 wants to find something, flashes forward, Last Breath is there, but he goes down so quickly, can't even pick up the kill.
Huge misplay by Lloyd. He ulted Kasing instead of Yharnam. Fate's Call saved him the entire fight, turned around at the teleports.
It's like Doa said, you know, Lloyd, it's your friend Lloyd, really.
Lloyd.
You do it. Yeah, he jumped in. Didn't think about Fate's Call, and again, this is what we talked about. It changes the dynamic of any 2v2 bot lane. He could have gotten a reset and cleaned up the fight instead. Mm-hmm. Takes the wrong target, lose the fight for his team. G4 wasn't there. We were talking about what did his team need to do. Well, HTK, they don't want team fight 5v5, but they want to move around and make picks. Ryu was 10, 15 seconds earlier in that bot lane than G4. You can see that again on the map. Look where Ryu is on the minimap already while this entire exchange is going on. And look where G4 is at the moment. He has to path down all the way. Moss is still level 5. That's why he's not dying. I think Ryu makes a mistake here from ulting Lloyd overall. So he should probably get out of there. That's why he gets popped here immediately. But then the remaining of the fight, this is a big mistake. Lloyd also, I think, flashes.
He also flashed to land the R.
Yeah.
On the support with Fate's Call, that is not excusable. That's a major mistake.
And then the dunks come through, and the funny thing is, I called it wrong. H2K didn't even use teleports for this. Oduamne, you mentioned at the very start of the game, he pushed his wave and he walked somewhere else off in bot lane. And they timed that with Ryu's roam as well. Ryu was already heading down. The entire team walked in the bot lane. The double teleport team all had walked in there. No summoners required, easy fight.
So that's a variation. Are you teleport to the bot lane, you walk back, or you walk there first, teleport back off into play if needed?
Well, 007X has found a very large Darius here in the jungle. Explosive cast come down. He's looking to try and start something here. Barrel's going to get the slow, but Lulex is around. There's the rocket jump. Try and close the distance as the Bangkok Titans picking a fight, but I don't know whether they'll be able to find too much.
That was an ult. He could have ulted Lulex and set up G4 for another attempt right there. This team still looks confused. 007X ulted Oduamne back and then walked away like, just kidding, I don't want to fight this anymore. And then kind of turned around and said, oh no, my team's coming. This is catastrophic for BKT.
I mean, Lloyd could have even ultied and proc the Yasuo ulti off the back of that one too, but they just weren't aware that Hyarnen was in the bottom river. He was a little slow on that rotation. Again, because HTK is playing really good with in terms of vision denial, double pink ward. If you can't see anybody, you have to assume that they're close. That's generally the way you play the game. So that's why you want river vision. If you can see somebody's trailing on the play, if they're behind it, you can punish, just like 007X being punished right here.
Most definitely, as Hyarnen's gonna pick it up, just presses E.
Beautiful block on the body slam, because Zing walked in to make sure nothing can happen there. Really nice play by H2K. You can see the mechanical skill difference. The heal from Odoamna, and also kill him. He doesn't have flash, though.
Yeah, Lloyd is gonna be able to hobble out of the way of that one, but that passive was doing so much damage.
Oh dear, this game is starting to really break apart now. H2K, I asked, you know, what are they going to do to break this game open? We know they're the more skilled team, and it was very intelligent roles by these players. We looked at BKT's lineup, and after the third pick, we're like, oh, this is a Yasuo composition. They even grabbed Tristana. They have a million ways and a half to set up G4. G4 is even winning mid lane for a short time, and yet they never set up these roams to pick people off from the side lanes.
Yeah, the correct play to play around a Yasuo composition is you roam away from him. You use the innate wave clear advantage that Lissandra brings to that matchup. You push him in, then you roam away from it. Doesn't matter how many setups he has for his ultimate if he's not arranged to cast that ultimate, and that's exactly what HTK did, and that is why they're right now 4,000-5,000 gold ahead of BKT.
Moss trying to save this turret here as well, Hyarnen. Only a couple more hits are going to be able to lock that one down. But first dragon, now 14 minutes here for H2K. It's just Kasing and Lulex hanging out. There is vision available for the Bangkok Titans, but no one's here just yet. And Hyarnen's going to have enough spears in it.
Yeah, look for the Bangkok Titans to just go all in for a group. That's what they want to do. They still have an incredibly teamfight-oriented composition. We've dubbed it the Exodia composition, where if you combine all members right here, G4 trading with Ryu.
Yeah, Frozen Tomb comes in, but there's the stun. Oh, everyone in for the party.
How about some overkill there, H2K? How about you go to the source of the Yasuo? You get him himself, multiple point and click stuns, easy pickup.
That wasn't too hard there. With H2K now with so much deep vision. You've been talking about the whole game, Crepo, and definitely know exactly what's going on.
Even their sweepers are used in unison there. You saw the smallest of Venn diagrams there. The circles barely touched, making sure that quad, like little section of the jungle had no wards in it to make sure these roams are going to continue to be safe. There's a pink ward as well, so that entire strip, that normal path you take to and from mid lane and that left side of the map, unobstructed by vision, they can keep using that until BKT rewards it as they do now.
Yeah, Odoamna has always had the support of either a player or multiple wards near him to make sure that he can push in his melee versus rain matchup and then just get the control and then leave. That's the way HTK have been playing, mostly because Hyarnen and Kasing, they've played with less resources but still trade out ahead because they were just a superior duo bot lane overall here. So HTK individually outclassing, but also in terms of approach to this game, just a step ahead of Bangkok Titans the entirety of the game.
Kasing now with Distortion Boots as well, so a roughly 4-minute cooldown on Flash now means, again, more plays can be made. This just game is opening up so quickly. The next 5 minutes probably going to be very explosive with H2K earning a lot of their gold very soon.
Odoamna actually looking for something here in the mid lane as G4 is getting a lot of attention. Of course, this guy does tend to be the carry for the team, but does like to split push, make himself a nuisance on the side lanes, but at the moment still just hanging around here in mid. And Kasing, it's the scariest little girl I've ever seen.
Have you seen the ring?
No, that's definitely too scary for.
I mean, if you compare the visions right now from H2K against Bangkok Titans, it is the complete opposite. H2K have a wealth of deep wards in the enemy jungle. The only really ward that trails ahead of the river is one ward around Scuttlecrab here from Bangkok Titans that sees Dragon. That's all they have. All their other wards are so far in their own jungle. So they're playing on a third of the map, and H2K, they're playing on the remaining two-thirds, and they can map out exactly where you are. And H2K, if they avoid the one way for Bangkok Titans to win this game, which is allowing them to group, they can simply just tear them apart left to right, split push, and then collapse when a pick. That's the way they usually play. Push out side lanes, force somebody to defend, and then collapse on one of the side lanes or just pincer mid. They do it really well over in Europe usually when they play, and I don't think Bangkok Titans are ready to counter such a play.
And Lloyd's getting completely zoned off. There's the flash forward. Flash a little bit late there from Lloyd as the kick lands as well.
He's smiting the creep. He smited the creep to let his Q connect. Really good play by Lulix there. Was body blocked by a creep, but he just said, I'll smite it out of way. Q connects into Insect.
And the stuns were layered beautifully enough. Ryu with the long range ulti walked forward to the W so that Lulex could walk to ult him instead of having to insect or to flash to make the kick happen. So a lot of things going right there for H2K. And you're just seeing the difference in the mechanical skill and coordination of these two teams. BKT, we knew were outclassed, but even just showing the examples of the high level of skill of the H2K players is nice to see.
And this Lissandra definitely looking okay as well. Another unique mid lane pickup.
No, we actually saw Kami play it.
Oh, that's
I believe.
A good point. That is a good point.
I believe he's actually the PTL
another
question
one for
winner.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Pain Kami, I believe, was the first player in week two to pick a new champion. With mid lane Lissandra, so who voted that one. Congrats to the Hall of Fame. Lulex knocked around, but only one man gets older, and that's the guy with Fate's Call on him. Nothing picked up. Odwamna soloing the front line. Ryu pushed back, but does it really matter? G4 caught up, and down goes Yasuo. Down goes 007. Three already. Warlock's bleeding to death, and Lulex can't quite land the Q. But now this poor Alistair going to be hunted for his meat. H2K yeah. wants a burger.
Oh, the apprehend not quite there. Moss just trampling his way away, doing his very best to get out.
But yeah, aggressive body slam there from 007X, Kasing here finishing off Warlock with Ryu, adding insult to injury. And when that knock-up combo fails, Odoano just says, thank you very much, and he just cleans up that fight entirely. They don't get Moss, he's still...
He's not German.
Yeah, at least he gets some deep wards right now, so that's something for Bangkok Titans. But overall, H2K really win that fight, because BKT can't even get their favorable combo off. Like, that yeah. was a two-man knock-up. You can suspend both people there, but if you just go for the Annie, then obviously Face Call comes in again.
Yes, we can watch this one again here. The knock-up, and he can't quite get it on the right person. Literally no damage dealt. A big knock-up from Moss. Like, if he waited for that one instead, and he got Hyarnen and Kasing yep. and Lulux together, it would have been beautiful here. But Ryu and Odwamna, basically together, those two take the backline by themselves. Tristana's already dead. The Gragas now isolated away from all his damage dealers, and it's just so easy to clean up there. And Ryu showing, actually, it was Mylon who played the Lissandra, how to do it right.
And yeah, just back with Titans, they're not mastering their own champions. They've made critical errors when it comes to playing against Fate's Call twice. Right now, Lloyd has been jumping in aggressively, using his flash even to interrupt his own jump. We saw 007X with the right play. Your group, you want to get a knock-up combo, but it's incredibly telegraphed and on the wrong members. You want to go for carries, because even if you kill the support and maybe the jungler, you're still going to lose out that fight, because H2K playing triple threat here.
And it's even Tank Lee Sin, right? He went Cinder Hulk after Sightstone there, so it's not like you're removing one of the damage threats. It's not even easy to kill either, so unfortunately the execution lacking here for BKT. And again, part of that is H2K making sure they're in the right place. Hyarnen, never the one in front, still zero deaths in this game. Ryu only dies when it's for a good trade for his team, so the option's not really even open for BKT.
Yeah, and H2K now just preparing for Baron. You can see so many wards around the area, but they're just clearing out the turrets while they can. G4, it looked like he was trying to get something happening, but this much of a gold deficit, what can you do? Odoamne's going to get caught out of position just a little bit, kicked underneath the turret, but look at the heal coming through. 007X is already dead. The shutdown finally comes through, but is it going to be enough? Warlock's going to die as well. It's a double kill for Hyarnen, and he's now hunting for more blood. Lloyd's going to fall shortly after as Ryu had picked up G4, and H2K is so far ahead.
That was absolutely the correct play to make for Bangkok Titans. Sadly, they were just too far behind for that to even work. The beautiful chain, layering CC on top of Odoamne, the biggest threat, the biggest carry, but he was just too tanky, gets one Q off, and suddenly that fight is lost.
And so is this inhibitor here as well, as H2K. Three dead on the side of the Bangkok Titans, able just to take control of this base.
There it is. 21 minute, 23 second inhibitor kill. H2K gonna put the record at 2-2. They can close out this game. Same record as Edward Gaming. So that again will be the match they're looking for later in the day.
Moss cancels Ryu here.
And they're gonna have some people showing up. Warlock.
Pixie.
Oh, good flash for Ryu. And the thing is, you have to time that right, because Pix will follow you after the flash and get you back in a range for the Glitter Lance. So fortunate timing there. Ryu guessed it correctly.
And Moss. Still trampling around this river. Sonic Wave doesn't land as Hyarnen's trying to get some pierces across.
Odoamne's back though, he wants more.
Actually lands the Q somehow, so he gets the heal off that, puts the bleed stack in. Now he's in the front line. G4 puts the windmill out to isolate Odoamne, but he's walking back pretty safely. Knock-up does not reach Hyarnen. There's the push in onto Odoamne. Exhaust is on, and they will pick up that kill. The fight continues with too much damage coming through already. Two kills for H2K. The third should be easy. Warlock flashes after ulting himself. The disengaged Lulex.
Yeah, the knockout flash, and it looks like Bangkok Titans looking to try and just make sure they don't lose too much from this situation. Odoamne is dead, but with a teleport, and Lloyd actually rocket jumping very aggressively. Sonic Wave is going to land, but the re-engage not going to come through.
Yeah, Buster shots him out of range, can't get enough burst there. Lloyd's just too far behind. Hyarnen takes a crit to the face, but who really cares? Ren's going to take him out. Hyarnen is dominating 6-0-7.
Just the unsung hero of this game, just picking up all of the kills off the back and so much consistent damage here for this Kalista with her two items.
Yeah, Kjaran, generally the more consistent player on H2K, you can always rely on a really decent to good AD carry performance from him. Especially on Kalista, Picky's mastered over the year, or not over the years, but over the months there in European Summer Split.
So?
And he actually completed a Bloodthirster from a longsword as well. So when I said two items,
a lot of money.
Three now, pretty quickly.
And the thing is, even though I suppose mathematically Last Whisper is a little bit more damage per gold here, there's just so little armor that that doesn't really matter. And the extra lifesteal just, it's a bit safer. He's facing up against the Yasuo and whatnot. Item builds aren't really that important, but Kjaran making sure he's pretty much unkillable in this late game.
Yeah, he's the only really threat that was slightly killable still on back on Titan's side. Yeah, they're funneling the damage to Oduwana. That's what they're doing, because positioning-wise, it's already incredibly hard to touch Kjaran in these fights. That means you got to go for Ryu. Well, he has Zhonyas and a built-in Zhonyas in his ultimate. Who do you focus? Darius. Well, who likes champions to be close to him focusing him? Darius does. So overall, it makes sense. It's easy to analyze it this way when HTK is 17,000 gold ahead, but
sure,
still need to itemize correctly.
Now with the Baron as well on top of that. So HTK now looking to push up these waves and get the last remaining couple of inhibitors as G4 and Moss trying to hold off Oduwamne, who's just a one-man wrecking ball at the moment.
And looking at the ahead at the match against EDG, momentum is very important, especially when multiple multiple games get played on the same day. EDG maybe a little distraught by the way they got dismantled by SKT, and HTK could feel confident here. I think the average level of play still was higher in the other game, but Lulex now gets caught.
Yeah, the ult come out. Ryu's going to ult himself as the exhaust comes down, but look at that massive frozen domain as Warlock able to ult himself, but there's just too much damage from H2K. Double kill already. G4 trying to make something happen, but that's just going to be a triple kill there for Kjaran.
That was a good play there by G4. He hexed Ryu when he came out of his frozen tomb, so he couldn't use his Zhonyas. Sadly for him, when you're down 17,000 gold, that's not enough. You need multiple good plays and a lot of mistakes for HTK. They don't make the mistakes and they're closing out.
Yeah, this one is just the gold lead here. The very end, though, we actually have some very good plays. 007X had Body Slam ready for the Glacial Path Jump as well, so Ryu was done when he first got in, but it's far too much now. The gold lead's there. A 25-minute win in the works here for H2K. They improved the 2-2, and the chance at making the quarterfinals is still alive.
Congratulations to HTK. That just looked like such a clean performance. And we spoke about the fact that the Bangkok Titans like to play scrappy League of Legends. Just looks like this sort of team fight composition doesn't really play to their strengths. And G4 was just way too far behind to get any sort of split push done.
I mean, that's the problem, is the early game did not go well. The lane swap, they got outplayed in this one. Oduwamne just completely outperformed Warlock, got around the map, made these roam plays, TPing back to lane. All that went absolutely beautifully for H2K. That was the early game lead, and you talked about, we heard, sorry, what Yamato Cannon said about H2K. Yep. They play textbook League of Legends. They're very good at the 5v0 style of game. You saw the lane swap, it worked out better. They invaded the jungle, but it didn't happen to them. They pulled BKT behind, didn't happen to them. They got the turret down first and got back to lanes first, didn't happen to them. The sort of 5v0 element of this game was all H2K, and when it came back to the regular fights, it was almost too late.
Lulex actually walked too far there. His team was like, Lulex, come on. They're about to bow. There he is. There he is back on your screen, ready for the bow to the crowd here. But yeah, Bangkok Titans, they could have done their research better, because the plays that H2K made here, they made already in the European LCS. That lane swap style was nothing new, nothing surprising, and they just started with an incredibly greedy start, not defending their weak side of the jungle where you can get punished the hardest, your double jungle. Yep. Fell behind in momentum, tower falls first. Bounce wave to Oduwamne. Once he potentially gets threatened, he makes that bounce wave into a push advantage, frees him up again. Suddenly he can move around. Eventually, Ryu breaks open out of that mid lane. He roams bot. There's no Yasuo setup anymore, and everything falls to pieces for the Bangkok Titans. So he had a good composition, but they didn't play to their strengths, just as we expected.
Yeah, and the team fight, the dive there in the bottom lane as well, where Ryu did actually fall down, but then the rest of the team picked up so many kills. How there were just tiny amounts of health on the members of H2K. Bangkok Titans must have thought, if we had have done this slightly differently, if this had have gone slightly better, then it would have been a much better situation. You mentioned the fact that the Buster Shot was used on the wrong targets, this sort of thing. That could have definitely weighed on the minds of the Bangkok Titans moving into the rest of the game, because that was the biggest swing.
Yeah, I mean, if you tilt off the face of the earth, you know, and you pull a full CLG, then you're just gone. And actually, you know,
too soon.
Possibly.
Never too soon, because now all the NA faith is with Cloud9 or TSM, so it just advances forward for all the NA fans out there. But, I mean, no, this was a game of BKT, I mean, obviously showing that they were an outclassed team. There were a number of mechanical misplays that even you or I, who are no longer on this stage playing, can point out and see things like, okay, that should have gone better. That
I mean,
was the
it's
made.
Always easy to point the mistakes.
Well, I know, of course it is.
It's really hard to execute them, but it is. It's in a heated moment. It is excusable in a sense to forget about Fate's Call, but if you want to advance out of groups, we're here at the world stages, you can't make those, you can't afford to make those mistakes, especially not when you're already holistically or macro level wise outclassed by another team, which used to be one of H2K's strengths until the other teams caught up and read their plays. H2K have pulled similar plays and gotten hard countered because people predicted their map moves. If BKT did better research or just better VOD reviews, they could have predicted some of these map moves here from H2K Gaming.
Or at least help themselves